Hello students, in this video we are going to see preparation and standardization of sodium thiosulfate. So this is one of the practical under pharmaceutical analysis one. So the aim for practical is to prepare and standardize 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate. Now before moving on to practical, let us see what is sodium thiosulfate. Sodium thiosulfate is Ne2S2O3, its molecular formula. Its molecular weight is 158.11 gram per mole. It is white, afluorescent, monoclinic, crystalline, odorless substance. It is sparingly soluble in water. It is used as antidote in cyanide poisoning, that is to counteract the effects of cyanide. It is used to nullify the effect of cyanide, that is antidote in cyanide poisoning, and also it is used as the anionic surfactant. So now why standardization is needed? Now standardization is necessary because many a times it is impossible to make the solution of accurately known concentration by weighing, because certain substances, they are reactive to atmosphere, that is they are not stable in the atmospheric conditions, so they cannot be weighed accurately, and hence exact concentration of solution can't be prepared. So before proceeding with any analysis such as assay, standardization of the titrant is necessary. So standardization means to determine exact concentration of the titrant. These are known as secondary standards, that is the titrant which is to be standardized will be known as secondary standard. So secondary standard, they are prepared in the laboratory for specific analysis, but it is not stable in its own form. For example, NaOH, it absorbs the moisture from surrounding. Then KMnO4 is highly susceptible to light. Also, as we have seen, Ne2S2O3, it is afluorescent, that is it may lose moisture when exposed to air. Hence all these substances need to be standardized. Thus they must be standardized against a primary standard before use. So standardization can be done with primary standards. So what are primary standards? These are the substances of high purity. Primary standards are used to determine the concentrations of other solutions to an extremely high accuracy. So let us see the requirements for primary standard. They should be easy to obtain, purify, dry, and to preserve in pure state. They should be almost 100% pure. They must be stable to atmospheric conditions, that is they must not decompose, or they must not be hygroscopic or deliquescent. So hygroscopic means they absorb moisture. Deliquescent means they absorb moisture and convert into liquid form. So all this should not happen. Then they should not have any water of hydration. If they will have water of hydration, they may lose moisture when exposed to dry air. They should be readily soluble. They should have high molecular weight to reduce the effect of weighing errors. Lower the quantity we weigh, higher are the chances of errors. Thus, if the substance will have high molecular weight, the chances of weighing errors will be less. Some examples of primary standards are sodium carbonate, which is used in acid-based titrations. Then in complex formation reactions, examples are zinc and magnesium. They are used to standardize the titrant EDTA. In precipitation reactions, silver and silver nitrate are used as primary standards. In redox reactions, potassium bromate and potassium dichromate, they are used as primary standards. So now let's come to the actual practical. So aim for our practical is to prepare and standardize 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate. So let us see the requirements. Apparatus we will require are beakers, conical flasks, then pipette, burette, funnel, butter paper, spatula. Chemicals we will require are sodium thiosulfate, then sodium carbonate, potassium bromate, starch solution, it is our indicator, and then potassium iodide, HCl. So now let us see the principle. It is based on the redox reaction, that is reduction and oxidation. And it is based on iodometry. Now, it is known as iodometry because in our conical flask, iodine will be liberated, which is reduced by sodium thiosulfate. So let us see how the iodine is liberated. And primary standard we are using is potassium bromate. So this titration takes place between the liberated iodine and sodium thiosulfate. On addition of Ki, that is potassium iodide, it reacts with HCl and Hi is liberated. That is, when we add Ki, that is potassium iodide, in our flask which already contains HCl, then hydrogen iodide is liberated. The liberated hydrogen iodide then reacts with potassium bromate and forms HiO3. So you can see again the iodate ions will be present in the flask. These iodate ions interact with the iodide ions coming from Hi, and this results in liberation of iodine. So you can see in the conical flask, iodine is liberated. So this liberated iodine is then reduced by sodium thiosulfate. Here starch solution is used as indicator. Now starch gives blue color with iodine. So initially when the iodine amount will be higher in our flask, we will have blue color due to reaction between the starch and iodine. Starch iodine complex gives blue color. At the end of titration, as all the iodine is reduced by sodium thiosulfate, blue color of starch iodine complex will disappear. So the color change is from blue to colorless, or you can say blue black color to colorless. So these are the reactions. Ki plus HCl will liberate hydrogen iodide plus KCl. Then these iodide ions react with KBrO3, potassium bromate, to give HiO3, hydrogen iodate, and potassium bromide. Iodate ions then react with iodine, and you can see the formation of iodine, that is liberated iodine. Iodine will be liberated in our flask. Now this liberated iodine is then reduced by sodium thiosulfate, which is Na2S2O3. So sodium thiosulfate plus iodine, we will get Na2S4O6 plus 6Na₂. Na2S4O6 is sodium tetrathionate. So you can see here 6 moles of sodium thiosulfate will react with 3 moles of iodine. So now let us see the procedure. So first is preparation of 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate. For this we have to weigh 25 gram of sodium thiosulfate and transfer it into a 1000 ml of volumetric flask containing water. Dissolve it by continuous stirring. Add 0.2 gram of sodium carbonate. This is added to prevent oxidation of sodium thiosulfate. Thus add 0.2 gram of sodium carbonate with continuous stirring. Finally make up the volume to 1000 ml. So if you don't require 1000 ml, you can weigh 2.5 gram and make up the volume to 100 ml. We have to keep the solution for at least 1 hour before standardization. So this is how you will prepare 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate. So how the actual standardization is to be done? So weigh accurately 0.1 gram of potassium bromate. Dissolve it in sufficient water to produce 250 ml of the solution. From this, pipette out 50 ml of the solution. Then add 1 gram of potassium iodide and 1.5 ml of 2 molar HCl. Okay, so as we have seen in the principle, HCl is required so that iodine will be liberated. So we are adding 1 gram of potassium iodide and 1.5 ml of 2 molar HCl. Now titrate this solution against sodium thiosulfate till it becomes pale yellow. Now you will observe that due to liberated iodine, the solution turns very dark orange. So we have to titrate before adding indicator. See, remember, we have not yet added indicator. Before adding indicator, titrate it with sodium thiosulfate until solution turns pale yellow. So this indicates that the concentration of iodine has been now reduced. Now we have to add starch indicator. So on adding starch, you will observe that the solution turns blue to black color due to formation of complex between starch and iodine. Now continue titration till the blue color disappears. Now, why we are adding starch towards the end and not earlier? Because if we add starch before titrating any of the iodine, what will happen? It forms a very strong complex with the iodine. And this complex is irreversible. We will not be able to break this complex if the concentration of iodine is very high. So what we do, first we titrate with sodium thiosulfate to reduce some concentration of iodine. Then we add starch indicator. So color change is then from blue-black to colorless. So let us see how to prepare 2 molar HCl and starch indicator. Take 16.7 ml of concentrated HCl and make up the volume to 100 ml of water. So this will give you 2 molar HCl. Now how to prepare starch indicator? Now starch indicator has to be prepared very carefully. So weigh 1 gram of corn or potato starch and mix it with 10 ml of distilled water. Now add this suspension to 100 ml of boiling water and further boil for 5 minutes. Now we will get a starch suspension, as starch is insoluble in water. Allow this solution to cool. Now remember, we always have to use freshly prepared starch. So now we have seen how to prepare one normal sodium thiosulfate, then how to proceed for titration and how to prepare reagents HCl and starch indicator. So now before we see the actual procedure or actual practical, let us see the factor calculation, which is very important for the calculation. So as we have already discussed the reactions, we know 6 moles of sodium thiosulfate will react with 3 moles of iodine to give sodium tetrathionate and sodium iodide. So here you can see 6 moles of sodium thiosulfate is going to react with 3 moles of iodine. Thus 6 moles of Na2S2O3 is equivalent to 3 moles of iodine. Now this iodine has been liberated from 1 mole of HiO3 and KBrO3 by reaction between them. Thus we can see that 6 moles of Na2S2O3 is equivalent to 1 mole of potassium bromate, that is KBrO3. So we can write 6 into 1000 ml of 1 molar Na2S2O3 is equivalent to 167.029 gram of KBrO3, because 166.029 is the molecular weight of KBrO3. Thus, 1000 ml of 1 molar Na2S2O3 will be equivalent to, we will divide 167 by 6. So this is equal to 27.84 gram of KBrO3. So 1000 ml of 0.1 molar, instead of 1 molar, we are converting it to 0.1 molar. So again, it will be equivalent to 2.784 gram of KBrO3. Thus, 1 ml of 0.1 molar Na2S2O3 is equivalent to 2.784 divided by 1000, which is 0.002784 gram of KBrO3. So the factor is 1 ml of 0.1 molar sodium thiosulfate is equivalent to 0.002784 gram of KBrO3. Now as molecular weight and equivalent weight of sodium thiosulfate is same, so we can also write 1 ml of 0.1 normal Na2S2O3 is equivalent to 0.002784 gram of KBrO3. So we are going to use this factor in our calculation of normality. So now let us see how to perform the practical.
Hello students, now we are going to see how to perform standardization of sodium thiosulfate. So for this I have prepared 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate. So I have dissolved 2.5 gram of sodium thiosulfate and made up the volume to 100 ml of water. To prevent the oxidation of sodium thiosulfate, we have added 0.2 gram of sodium carbonate solution. So the principle is iodometry. So KBr is used as the primary standard. So I have taken 25 ml of KBr in the polymer flask. Now to this we are going to add Ki, 1 gram of potassium iodide. So after adding 1 gram of potassium iodide, we are going to add 1.5 ml of HCl, 2 molar HCl. Now see, as you can see, the color of the flask has changed. So why it has, is it so? Because here the principle is, first of all, Ki will react with HCl to liberate HI, that is butyric acid. This butyric acid then reacts with KBrO3, potassium bromate, which we have already added, to liberate iodate ions. Now this iodate ion will again react with the iodide and iodine will be liberated. So due to liberated iodine, the color is, you can see, dark red. Now we will titrate it against sodium thiosulfate. So before proceeding to titration, let me tell you about the indicator. Indicator which we are going to use is starch indicator. Now we will add starch at the end of the titration. Why so? Because if we add starch initially, what will happen? Starch will form a strong complex with iodine and it will not be liberated even at the end point. So first we will titrate few ml with sodium thiosulfate. Then after the color becomes faint, we will add starch indicator. So I will start the titration now. You can see the pivotaline has been adjusted to 0 mark. Pivot contains sodium thiosulfate. You can see color is becoming faint because iodine is being reduced by sodium thiosulfate. So you can see here the color has become faint. So few iodine has been reduced by sodium thiosulfate. Now we will add starch as the indicator. We are going to add 1 ml of starch. On addition of starch, the color becomes black. This is due to reaction of starch with iodine. Now we will titrate till our color, black color, disappears. So you can see the black color has fully disappeared. So now we will proceed for the second reading. Again, I have adjusted the mark to 0. I have taken our solutions. So, we will start the calibration now. You can see color is becoming faint. That is, iodine is being reduced by sodium thiosulfate. Yes. So, now you can see it is yellowish. So, now we will add our indicator, that is we had approximately 1 mm. You can see color has changed to black due to formation of complex pigment iodine and starch. So now you can see the color has been discharged. Now we will proceed for the third reading. So I have taken the contents, divided sodium thiosulfate drop by drop. You can see the color has become pale. Now we will add starch. We always have to use freshly prepared starch. Now we will continue the calculation. So you can see the color has disappeared. So we have taken the three readings. Now let us see the observation table. So this is our observation table. We have taken three readings. First reading was 5.67. Initial we had marked the burette to 0. So difference 5.67. Similarly, second reading was 5.8. Third was 5.8. So the average comes out to be 5.73 mm. So now we will take this burette reading and we will proceed for further calculations. So now we will see the calculations. So factor, as we have already seen in the theory part, 1 ml of 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate is equivalent to 0.002784 gram of potassium bromide. So instead of 1 ml, now we will write here our burette reading into x normal. This we have to assure is equivalent to 0.02 gram KBRO3. Our conical flask contains 0.02 gram KBRO3. So now let us see how we have got this value. So KBRO3 was prepared by dissolving 0.20 gram in 250 ml of water. So we had pipetted out 25 ml. So 25 ml of solution will contain 0.02 gram of KBRO3. So that is why we have kept here 0.02 gram KBRO3. Burette reading, as we have seen, the average of three readings was 5.73 ml. So 5.73 ml into x normal sodium thiosulfate is equivalent to 0.02 gram KBRO3. Now to find out x, that is normality, there are simple calculations. We will compare equation 1 and equation 2. So by simply cross multiplication, our value comes out to be 0.13 normal. So let us now see the result. So normality of sodium thiosulfate was found to be 0.13 normal. Thank you.
So as we have seen in the practical, the normality of prepared sodium thiosulfate is found to be 0.13 normal. Let us see some of the questions for synopsis. So what are primary standards? So as we have discussed, these are the substances of high purity and they are used to determine the concentration of other solutions to an extremely high accuracy. That is to determine the concentration of secondary standards. Sodium thiosulfate acts as reducing agent or oxidizing agent. Sodium thiosulfate, we have seen, it converts iodine into iodide. Hence, it acts as reducing agent. Why starch is added towards the end of the titration? If we add starch before the titration, what will happen? It will form a strong complex with iodine, because initially the concentration of iodine in the flask will be very high. Thus, very strong complex will be formed between starch and iodine. This complex will not decompose even at the end of the titration. So starch is added towards the end. So during this time, the concentration of iodine is reduced because some of the iodine has been reduced by the sodium thiosulfate. What is the difference between iodimetry and iodometry? So iodometry, in iodometry, liberated iodine is reduced. Whereas in iodometry, iodine directly takes part in the reaction. That is, iodine is directly titrated with the reducing agent. And in iodometry, liberated iodine takes part in the reaction. What are some of the examples of oxidizing agent? So one example we already have seen, that is iodine, because it is being reduced by sodium thiosulfate. Hence, it oxidizes sodium thiosulfate. So other examples are potassium iodate, potassium bromate, ceric ammonium sulfate. Give example of self-indicator. So we have seen in one of the other redox titrations, we have seen KMnO4, it acts as a self-indicator. Now, how will you prepare one normal sodium thiosulfate? So for this, we have to weigh 250 gram of sodium thiosulfate and transfer it to 1000 ml of volumetric flask containing water and then make up the volume to 1000 ml. So for 0.1 normal, we have to weigh 25 grams. 0.1 normal, we have weighed 25 grams. So for 1 normal, we will have to weigh 250 grams. Thank you.